bad talk inside the house they bring. And when I talk, they start to sing. Come a little boo-boo.
Good evening. I am John Mida, the president of Rhode Island School of Design. This is a packed house. The lights are low, but I want to get a sense of, kind of wave your hand when I ask a question here. So who's from Providence, Rhode Island? Okay, I hear that, I'm hearing that. Who's from outside Providence, Rhode Island? I think the outsiders win tonight. I've just been sort of blown away by the opportunity to sit with Mr. Belafonte for dinner just a few minutes ago, actually. And, you know, when you have a small occasion, a dinner party, and you sit next to someone you've admired for so many years in your life, and you whisper something to them, and you see what they'll whisper back, and I whispered to Mr. Belafonte, you know, you've lived an amazing life. And he kind of looked in the distance and turned to me and said, "Don't tell anybody." I want to note that everyone knows this. And just by witnessing the audiences gathered here tonight, here at Rhode Island School of Design. And I had a chance to talk to some of the people that are here to learn from you, as they've learned from you all their lives. And I want to note Margaret Allen over there, who is 93 years young, who met you, Mr. Belafonte, in 1946, so reunited. But I see many people in this audience who have maybe met you, heard of you, seen you, and this is a special occasion for all of them to share this evening. I want to share a quote that I love about Mr. Belafonte's philosophy. Of art, because you know, art is a philosophy at RISD. Art is activism. Art is everything you ever cared about. And he said, "Art, there's nothing more powerful in the universe than it, because it is the recorder of the truth." It is that idea of the truth that is core to artists, core to what we represent here at RISD. And we're delighted to feel that truth from you this evening. You know, this is part of a larger celebration in recognition of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s heroic work to change the course of history. Maybe some of you are aware, but I was greatly influenced by his teachings, his thinkings. I grew up in Seattle, Washington. Anyone from Seattle, Washington? Oh, a few. Thank you, Seattle people. I grew up in Seattle, Washington. I grew up in the southern part of Seattle, which was the underprivileged part. We didn't have very good schools in that side of Seattle. And I was part of the desegregation movement. We were bused from South Seattle to North Seattle, where the schools were much nicer. They were more racially Caucasian. And my life changed because of that. But I noticed that every morning I would take the bus, and we would ride up Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Way to North Seattle, and so that always rings in my mind, the opportunities that Dr. King enabled for many of us in this country. I want to quote something you have already heard in different forms. You heard President Obama give his elegant inauguration speech, but there's a passage that I want you to all focus on that has a special feeling in it. President Obama said in his inauguration, "We recall that what binds this nation together is not the colors of our skin or the tenets of our faith or the origins of our names. America's possibilities are limitless, for we possess all the qualities that this world without boundaries demands: youth and drive, diversity and openness, and endless capacity for risk and a gift for reinvention." I know the RISD students here tonight know what that sounds like. That's what it feels like at RISD in this country. You know, students reflect the community in so many ways, and Maggie, who's from apparel, is taking photographs right over there. Hi, Maggie. I was like, "So Maggie, what do you think about this evening?" And she said to me, "It's a big deal." And she added, "You know, if you're not here tonight, what are you doing? So all of you who are here this night have made the right choice. Just a few minutes ago, sat with Mr. Belafonte, and he said something that really resonated with me and our community, I believe, as well. This idea of art reformulated. He said, "The world is in need of civilized mischief. Art is at the forefront of that need." And that need is represented in so many ways by how we're fortunate at RISD. I want to acknowledge Mr. Michael Spalter, the chairman of the RISD board. Michael Spalter, please stand. Michael Spalter, a man of passion, a man of vision, a man of art, a man of business. I asked, "How do you feel, Michael?" And he said, "To think he was with Dr. King at that moment, to be in the same room with him." And he's wearing a Coexist shirt, by the way, so you can catch him in the audience later. And I want to recognize our provost, Roseanne Summerson. Roseanne, where are you? Roseanne, our academic officer. Leader of our faculty. Thank you. And a special guest, the Honorable Congressman David Cicilline. Could you please come up to say a few words?
Thank you. It's really a great pleasure to be here. First, to say thank you to President Mitre for launching this MLK celebration here at RISD. And I can think of no more wonderful a person to deliver this lecture than Mr. Belafonte, who, you know, Dr. King spoke so much and is remembered for his beautiful and eloquent words. But what he really spoke about was action, about bringing about the beloved community through a lot of hard work. And in so many ways, Mr. Belafonte represents both the beauty he's brought to our world through his music, but also the justice and equality and fairness and peace that he has brought to the world because of his advocacy. So I'm delighted to be here and say welcome.
Thank you. I want to thank you, Congressman Cicilline, for leading creativity in our nation's capital. And a real U.S. congressman. Pretty cool, huh? I'd like to next welcome Dan Kavicki to the stage. Dan is the Dean of Liberal Arts at RISD. He's focused much of his scholarly and professional work on music for social change. Dan, by the way, is a scholar of many colors, of many different frequencies and intensities, and I want to welcome Dan to the stage. Come on up, Dan.
I get to introduce Harry Belafonte. So cool. Anyway, I am going to be moderating tonight's proceedings, which will include remarks by Mr. Belafonte, as well as a Q&A session and a book signing. We do have a full house tonight gathered here, and also for a simulcast in the Chase Center. And I just wanted to say before we begin, for all of you here and for all of you over there, actually, just everybody, please silence your cell phones. So, where can I possibly start to introduce you to the exceptional achievements of Harry Belafonte? For me, the best way to sum up his work is to think about the voice. The voice, of course, is the key tool of any singer and actor. And Mr. Belafonte's emergence as a star in the 1950s was centered on his controlled baritone, textured with a slight rasp, punctuated with his sharp articulation, capable of a kind of raw, explosive emotion. His voice could work wonders with audiences. Starting out as a jazz crooner, he soon expanded to a broad repertoire of spirituals, calypso, gospel, the blues, folk. In all, he transformed the melodic simplicity of traditional songs into passionate and irresistible declarations of a diverse world. In movies,
Broadway, and television too, his voice became a recognizable element of the sonic landscape of America. He was the first African-American to have a million-selling record, the first African-American to win a Tony, the first African-American television producer, the first African-American man to win an Emmy, the first African-American to host The Tonight Show. There's this list of superlatives reflecting his boundary-breaking achievements as a singer and an actor, and it goes on and on. The idea of the voice, of course, also emphasizes the importance of Mr. Belafonte's social and political activism. More than any other entertainer in the latter half of the 20th century, Mr. Belafonte has given his voice, enhanced by his celebrity, to the cause of global equity and human rights. This is like that Kevin Bacon game, name a social justice movement since the 1950s, and you can connect Mr. Belafonte to it. He was a confidant of Martin Luther King and a strategist for the civil rights movement. He was a cultural advisor to the Peace Corps and liaison between civil rights leaders and leaders of liberation movements in Africa. He was a public advocate for the American Indian movement. He established Trans-Africa, a group instrumental in shaping the anti-apartheid divestment movement. He was the founder of USA for Africa and was instrumental in its benefit album, We Are the World, which addressed widespread famine in Ethiopia. He was a UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador, conducting fact-finding in Rwanda just after the 1994 genocide, and later working across Africa to promote public education and awareness of HIV and AIDS. He organized Nelson Mandela's triumphant tour of the United States in 1990. More recently, he organized the Gathering for Justice, a nonprofit group addressing the crisis of youth incarceration. And he led the movement against U.S. invasions of Iraq and Afghanistan. And I'm only touching the surface here of his incredible record of activism. This is not just about Harry Belafonte's voice, though. All voices are central to a functioning democracy. And America is a country with a robust history of declarations, public hearings, presidential debates, oral arguments, freedom of expression, mainstream voices, minority voices, dissenting voices. We all want a chance to speak, and we all want to receive a fair hearing. It's why Walt Whitman celebrated America singing in 1850, and it's also why some of the most deeply troubling historical moments in U.S. history have involved silencing, from the Sedition Act in 1798, to the electoral exclusion of women and minorities in the 20th century. In this light, Mr. Belafonte has done something quite extraordinary throughout his career. Not only has he raised his voice in song, not only has he given his voice to the cause of social justice, but he has, in doing those things, created new spaces in which those made voiceless can speak themselves and participate anew in public discourse. In Protestant Christianity, there is a tradition of being called to service, of hearing a voice that guides one to speak and act in the world, sometimes in ways that are contrary to worldly assumptions about value or success. And however you might feel about the religious nature of this phenomenon, its basic idea has animated democratic activism and change for centuries. Voicing, hearing, and action are deeply intertwined. In that spirit, let us listen now in the hope that we might find the inspiration to speak and act ourselves. Ladies and gentlemen, let us give a warm welcome to Mr. Harry Belafonte.
Thank you all very, very much. I am delighted to be here in more ways than the evening will permit me to describe. That doesn't mean much to you, but to have discovered the Rhode Island School of Design and to be invited to speak before you was, upon first view, just another invitation from a respected institution of learning that during this time of the year reaches out to those of us in the community who have some basis on which to speak with authenticity about Dr. King and our movement. And I kind of prepare myself for these events feeling somewhat secure and that the information that will be imparted may not be inspiring, but it will be accurate. But tonight, at John Maeda's home, I was invited to not only meet the guy who pushes the engine, but to also meet his staff and to meet people in the administration of this institution. And the level of discourse and just the very brief things that were said at the table, I realized that I was in an environment that is not the ordinary. And so I'm trying to live up in some extraordinary way to what I'm experiencing standing here. When I turned 80 years old, some time ago, I had come to the decision that I would stop performing. That I was in Hamburg, Germany, and all had gone well. I was rewarded by the generosity of a global public that gave me stamina, that gave me a sense of belonging, and the people who gave me the encouragement to speak out openly and freely on subjects sometimes that artists and people who are caught in the public light sometimes shy away from. But I took a look, and I had not been too preoccupied with the idea that the end was in sight. But that night, I walked on stage for the final bow, and I realized that that would be the last time that I would be singing in public. I had made the commitment to leave and to do something that I wanted very much to do, and that was to take my wife and let's try to find anonymity and go places in the world that were strange and new to us. And we did that. We went to Madagascar and saw the lemurs and the strange creatures that you can't find anywhere else in the world. And we went to Costa Rica, to the rainforest. And then right after that, we went to a tiny island in the Caribbean that I had not visited before. And went in with this sense of desired anonymity. And I heard playing in a little hut, which was the record store, songs that were blaring out onto the street. And as I came close to that store, I decided to go in and to look through the music, what was local tastes suggesting, what were the songs of the indigenous, what could be inspiring. Just let me satisfy this moment of curiosity. And so I walked in, and there was a lady, fairly softic, sitting at the table and reading a tabloid magazine and looking carelessly into space. And as I walked through the store, I looked into the bins, and I kept looking at titles, and I saw Bruce Springsteen, and I saw Stevie Wonder, and I saw so many artists that I knew. And as I continued looking for where sat the music of the indigenous, I kept seeing more and more celebrities, all of whom I knew. But I was struck by the fact that one name didn't find. And a touch by ego, I looked and began to have real focus and purpose. And I turned to the lady and I said, excuse me, miss, but do you have any records here by a singer by the name of Harry Belafonte? And she looked up and she said, who? And I said, Harry Belafonte. And she says, no. You know something? When the boat come in here with all them people from North America and other places in the world, them come here and they ask for that man. But you know something? I think he long time dead. Thus, I hastily got back into the world of public appearance. This time, I decided to take advantage of some of the offers that were extended to me to speak to institutions and organizations who want to know. And now, on this occasion, not unfamiliar to me, we're going to speak about Dr. King and the moments that have great impact for what we're about here at this very moment in our existence. John F. Kennedy, when he made his inaugural address, said in one phrase, a moment, ask not what the nation will do for you, but what will you do for the nation? I'm paraphrasing, but that was the essence of his remarks. And it caught everybody with a sense of mission and purpose. And there's an interesting way in which the president put the question to the citizens of this country. There were some of us, however, were somewhat in wonderment. To be more precise, what was he asking if we should not ask what the nation would do for us, but what would we do for the nation? What was he asking people of color? What was he asking African Americans in that specific space to respond to? Certainly, no group in this country has demonstrated more to giving this nation than the black community. And before them, certainly, no community had done more to shape what America was when it was discovered by the Europeans than did the indigenous Native Americans. And yet, when the new citizens came to this country, there was not harmony to be realized. There was this imposition of greed and a lust for power. So much so that as the European population grew, the native and the indigenous population dwindled. Violence came with the new conquerors. And after many years of that plunder, the indigenous disappeared. There were not enough of them to continue to fulfill the ambitions of the new citizens, the newly arrived. And so, for the next 100 years, slavery became the instrument of public engagement. 100 years, Black Americans gave to this country a huge gift. We made cotton king. Benjamin Banneker designed and slaves built the beautiful capital of Washington, D.C. We built the railroads in this country along with many other alien folk, foreigners. And all through this time, as we kept pushing forward, America was, on the other hand, fulfilling something that was quite interesting and would turn out to be one of the most important social experiences of civilization's existence. The fact that the slave and the slaver, the indigenous and the newly arrived conqueror, would be put upon to find a harmonious way in which to blend our experiences and to find commonality in our future interests became a huge challenge. Could America fulfill a dream that it had set for itself, although much of the social behavior was contrary to what that dream said it wanted to be? Place of freedom, place of free speech, place free to worship, to think, free to yield a harvest for those who were willing to work. All these things were mingled in with this DNA of greed, of power. And so, in that context, when I was born, it was in Harlem, in New York City. My mother was an immigrant woman. She came from the island of Jamaica, and on occasion lost her papers, and for a while lived outside the law. And as a consequence, we were always distracted with the fact that someone was investigating or hunting her down while she was undereducated and without resources, desperately trying to find work. For children that she had wanted to support, that she had brought into the world much too young in her own years. But she did the best that she could. And all that we began to know about life was seen through her prism, through her lens. She did not master the language, but she had a great sense of justice, and her instinct for truth was quite remarkable. And she constantly imparted to her children, no matter how much was heaped upon us, that continued to force us to think that somewhere along the line we were made of inferior stuff. She made us understand that we were not inferior, that we could be anything that we wanted to be if we only applied the right tools. That was easily said for a mother. It was very difficult for us to find our way through that suggestion and through that labyrinth. At the age of 17, having been a dropout, serving only half of the first term of high school, I was slipped with a learning disorder that plagued me all through my youth. And then the social circumstances of poverty and violence and gangs inundated my youth. And one of the things that I did to flee from all this was to volunteer to serve in the armed forces, United States Navy, during the Second World War as a munitions loader. But I didn't come just to escape social pressure. I came because my mother's insight on the issues of race, on the issues of immigration, on the issues of America, and her mad affair with Franklin Delano Roosevelt and the fireside chats, she constantly kept before us the sense that there was something else to this America, something else that we had to be involved with and engaged with. And that led to a moment when Italy invaded Ethiopia. My mother's regard for Haile Selassie, the emperor, we saw a newsreel in which the emperor was speaking before the League of Nations, pleading for protection against the might of the fascist armies coming from Italy. And she saw him disgraced. She saw him speaking before a body of world leaders that were indifferent to his cause and to his plea. And she said to us, we had a task. We should not let Haile Selassie go unavenged. She came from a little place in the island of Jamaica called St. Anne, which had the distinction of being the home of a man by the name of Marcus Garvey. And as a Garveyite, she would impart to us sayings and teachings and things that constantly crowded our thoughts. So when I came into the Second World War, it wasn't just to escape from poverty and the stress and strains of the streets of New York. It was also a mission. We said that that war was to save democracy, to make the world free, for people to be able to love and live, to be able to worship, to be able to have all the pleasures that democracies yield. And when I got into the armed forces, I was amazed at the diversity of not only America in itself, but the great diversity that existed within the black community. I never heard so many different dialects for one language as I heard in the black divisions of the armed forces in the United States. I heard people from Mississippi and from Alabama speaking in tongues that I needed an interpreter for. But then I began to see in this America things that I had not realized in the streets of New York. And that gave me a sense of a larger universe. And then I began to look at the world at large, what was going on with fascism and Hitler, and what was going on with all of the forces that came into play in this great war. And I found that France and Holland and England and Portugal and several places, including Germany, all speaking about the world order, especially the Allies, speaking about democracy, and pressing into service people that were made up of their constituency, were in the colonies of the Far East, of people that came from Vietnam and Cambodia and Thailand, and people that came from Africa, and people that came from all over the world and were caught up in this great war. And many of us fought with the expectations that if we were victorious, we would come back to a new day and a new order. And when we came back, expecting that since we had won, the world was now on the march to a new horizon, that there would be freedom of speech, that there'd be opportunities abound, that we would be able to vote. And when we came back to America, and all those people in the colonies that served the colonial empire went back to their villages and other places, they found that there was no generosity from the conqueror. Here in America, GIs, black servicemen, were put upon in ways that have never been part of the discourse of in looking at our history. Black soldiers came back with a feisty sense of not only to be rewarded by the victory, but what the issues were about. We had stopped Hitler, we had stopped the sense that there was a racial superiority abound somewhere in the world. We put an end to that, and democracy. But when we came back, there was not a place at the table of victory. And so black soldiers and black servicemen were beaten and maligned, and the Ku Klux Klan and new and more cruel segregation laws were pushed through the system. And those of us who had been trained to be combatants and in the ways of weaponry had a choice: to acquiesce to the new order based upon the old principles, or to reject that and challenge the system. And many of us opted to do the latter. We were quite prepared to go into violence, quite prepared to do what was necessary to avenge and to extract from the society what we felt we were entitled to. But then something stepped into that space, and it was a new and a radical thought. And this new and radical thought came from a man who said, "I am of the struggle, but let's look at another way in which to deal with our adversaries." And he introduced the concept of nonviolence. And many looked at that as a fool's pursuit. But some of us got caught. When Dr. King called, I was well on my way with my career. I had attained a place of public notoriety. I had been known for my willingness to engage in debate and issues that was concerning us socially. And Dr. King called and said, "I'm coming to New York to speak to the religious community to press them into service, and I would welcome an opportunity to have a chat with you." And we met in a church in the basement up in Harlem, Abyssinia. And I listened to him speak to the ecumenical community, talking about what was to be expected of those men of religion who spoke about Christianity and spoke about Judaism and all of the things that God had commanded them to serve. And I was quite taken with him. He was very young. He was 24. And I was just 2 years older than he. And as I listened to him speak, I was caught up not only with the eloquence with which he spoke, but the depth of content and sense of purpose. And his mission, as he articulated it to me, instantly attracted my involvement. He said that he had many questions about his right to be in the place in which he found himself. He didn't know that he could make decisions that would lead people into harm's way, that would have life and death consequences, and that he needed to have around him people that he could trust and people that he could rely on. And I was quite touched with the fact that he saw those qualities in me. After all, I didn't have any lofty place in which to exercise my sense of history and all the things that I was later required to apply. but we met, and we got on with it. And what struck me was the way in which he used his cunning, his intelligence, the way in which he applied himself to thought, in which he encouraged us to think outside the box, the way in which he said, we cannot any longer use the tools that they give us to argue the questions of our rights. We must find a way to become more radical. And the word radical, which always to me meant violence and meant turn off, I found that in his sense, this radical thought was the place to reside, was the place to be, was the place for us to take the movement, radical thinking. And it was quite abundant. Many men and women came to the table filled with radical thought and radical feelings. And what was surprising was that so many of them should have been so young. So many in SNCC, so many in SCLC, so many in the organizations that made up our movement. When I met John Lewis, a very highly respected congressman today, he was 18. When I met Julian Bond, he was 18. When I met Jesse Jackson, he was 18. When I met Diane Nash, she was 17 and with child. And when I looked around at Dr. King himself, and some of his colleagues, they were just barely in their 20s or mid-20s. What a large crowd of people filled with radical thought who had come from our communities. We hadn't seen them. We had not heard great speeches from any of them. They were just in that space, feeling the urgency of what America should be, of what they wanted the world to be. And they knew that they needed radical purpose and radical thoughts to change the landscape. And that brings me to now. What I find missing mostly in the American discourse is the rejection of radical thought. Our political leaders do not speak with radical purpose, with radical ways for change. They speak within the same dull space that they inherited from past oppressors, and they apply the same terms for today's mission. Last time I saw Dr. King in person was in my home. The day before he went down to Memphis, we met with the leadership of the organization to make sure that we understood clearly our instructions and what we were about. We are now embarking on what was for him the most important moment in our struggle. He had created what he called the Poor People's Campaign. And this campaign was no longer just about the space in which women looking for freedom filled, black people looking for racial relief filled, Latinos coming looking for freedom among immigrant workers, among Native Americans who had been relegated to reservations and living a life that was deeply subhuman. All this was a call to this constituency to come and invade the capital of America and to not leave that capital until the halls of justice and our legislature gave us what we deserved and what we were asking for. And so we met at my home for last-minute instructions, because the next day he was on his way down to Memphis. At that meeting, Dr. King had a very severe countenance. He seemed moody and distracted. And in the middle of our exchange, we asked him what was wrong. And he said, you know, we fought long and hard for integration. And we have, in this integration movement, come to many milestones, many moments of great victory and success. But now I have a thought that is overwhelming me, and it is that I've come to believe that our integration movement, and that in our integration movement, we are integrating into a burning house. And that insight, that remark, rather prophetic remark, caught us off guard. Here you are getting ready to move into the biggest of our campaigns. Not that things that we've done previously, getting the right to vote, changing the laws, ending segregation, all of that was in itself quite mighty. But now to talk about changing the economic paradigm, to talk about the redistribution of the nation's wealth, to reach out to the underserved, was the heart and the nerve center of America and those who controlled it. And now we were stepping into the space. And for him to say that he thought we were integrating into a burning house was not the most inspiring thought for the rest of us. So he was asked, what would you have, if your thoughts are so, what would you have us become? What would you have us do? And he said, we're just going to have to become firemen. I didn't understand how prophetic that remark was and what the metaphor was about, but until late into the life that was yet to come, Bush emerged. And not that things had not been leading up to that moment, but he was to epitomize what Dr. King meant when he said we were integrating to a burning house. We'd come to a place where our democracy was more threatened than we'd ever known it to be, more threatened than by fascism and the Nazis, more threatened by than the economic highs and lows we had experienced. The greatest enemy to democracy and to this America that we were struggling for was being threatened from within. And now, here we were looking at a regime that not only stole an election with the support of the institutions of government that gave them that opportunity, but then it began to lead us into global consequences that we are still struggling with. They lied to us, they misled us, and we went into a war with a country that did us no wrong, and we lied to the American people, and we sent our sons and daughters into battle. This was where I saw Dr. King's remarks as being most prophetic. We're integrating into a burning house. And America, which was faced with this dilemma, with this period, struggled with all that we were experiencing. The collapse of the economy, run on the banks, going off to foreign places with intrigue, falsely gathered. And then the American people spoke when a young man stepped into the space of politics, and he was to bring to America a promise that was filled with radical thought and radical possibilities. What attracted many of us to Barack Obama was the fact that he was black, the fact that he was from the community, the fact that he was a Harvard graduate, the fact that he had a great sensibility of what was going on with the poor, and certainly with black youth, that he was stepping into a space where, in America, where we have the largest prison population in the world, he understood that the large groups of black and Latino presence in those prisons were part of the inequity and the absence of an equilibrium in our social thrust. And in that place, he said, "Yes, we can." And all of us picked up that theme, "Yes, we can." And we marched into the new day. We had found someone who could have been the best of all of our choices to be the leader of the fire brigade. But something was askew, and many of us had to pause long enough to take a look at what was missing. In the great dialogue in America, there was no discussion about prison population, about how many young black men and women were being shuttled off into this new slavery, into this new plantation. There wasn't much debate about what was going on with the poor. As a matter of fact, the word poor was hardly ever part of the great pronouncements. And so we had to take a look at how to deal with this strange phenomena. A man of color, not speaking of race, a man who understood the dynamics of the banks and the economic systems, speaking only about the middle class. And so he had this moment of distraction, this moment of preoccupation. But we stayed the course. He did some things that captured our fancy, that delighted many of us, and we should be appreciative of the fact that he got us to these places. What happened with the laws involving the people in the gay community, and the delights that are emerging from his deeper look into the lives of gay people. We certainly are very much enhanced by his view of women and the laws that he passed, helping women to understand more or realize more for their economic engagement, and certainly healthcare. But we still are at a war. We are still filled with military intrigue. We are still doing things that violate conscience and violate international law. We are still caught in this space, or this place, of the use of power and the abuse of that power. We're caught in a place where we do not have enough time for those who are at the bottom of the ladder. We are not preoccupied with the conditions of the poor. We have not been able to change much about that direction we are headed for. And so, I look upon his second anointing as a time for us to engage in radical thought, for us to engage in radical behavior. And what I talk about when I go to the campuses of America is the fact that the place where we should be most engaged in talking about ways in which to fix what is broken is the debate that we're not engaged in. I don't find radical thought abounding in the campuses of America. There are individuals who would like to speak and think radically for the good, but it's not part of the greater exchange as we had in the campuses of America during the 50s and the 60s. And I find that more and more young people whom I speak to in these campuses, on these campuses, are hungry for thoughts that they have not yet been exposed to, hungry for ideas they have not been exposed to, asking me questions that are so accessible, I wonder why they have a question. How did you do it? Well, we've left so many instructions, so many victories that are still quite tangible. You can just look at what we all did, black and white and women and gays, and the great struggle left us ample instructions on what to do. And I said, you know, one of the great problems that Dr. King would speak to was how indifferent people were to the plight of the poor, how indifferent to those who were filled with a life of convenience and a life of pleasure, how indifferent they were to what was happening to those who were ground under. And it wasn't until we challenged that indifference that the country was forced to wake up and to take a look. And I often recite to them a poem that was given by a Polish worker back at the turn of the century, when this Polish worker was speaking to the industrialists, and he gave a warning. And he said, calculate carefully and ponder it well, and remember this when you do, that my two hands are mine to sell. They made your machines, and they will stop them too. I think that the delights and the hedonist, heady way in which we spin off our lives on a daily basis should be impeded, should be disrupted. I think too many people have no sense of priority. They have no sense of what's happening to fellow beings. Everything is a statistic. And herein, I think, lies something that might be specifically valuable to the school. When I was a janitor's assistant, which was the job that I had coming out of the Second World War, I had done a repair in an apartment, and I was given as a gratuity two tickets to the theater. I'd never been to a theater. I'd been to music halls and saw the great artists of the day, but I'd never been to the theater, the house of drama. So in this basement, in this small place, the Schomburg Library in New York City, I went out of curiosity to see what this was about. And I could tell, it was a packed house, 40 people, that was the size of the theater. And there were 40 black people. And there was an unusual silence that told me that I was to expect something unique. I'd never been in a place where you had 40 black people and there was absolutely no noise. So I said, something's up. And then I realized what it was. The house lights went down, the curtains opened, and the players came on stage. And as they spoke the poetry of the playwright, as they walked through the drama, the audience found itself laughing, found itself caught up with suspense, but they were very much engaged, and most of all, they were being instructed and inspired. And I knew that this was the place where I wanted to be very much. It was most fortuitous that also in that space, at the same time, having the same experience, was a young man by the name of Ossie Davis, and a young woman by the name of Ruby Dee, and another young man by the name of Sidney Poitier, and another man by the name of Ellsworth Smith. I looked at these people, and we had all come out of the war. Most of us were ex-servicemen. And what a curious thing that all these black people had stepped into this space looking for a life in theater. What in the world drove us to that? Our choice is still a query. Because when I told my mother that I was going to use the resources given to servicemen to go fund learning to be an actor. She went into a decline from which she never recovered. And no matter what I achieved, no matter how big the success, no matter how big the anointing, she'd always say to me, it's a wonderful thing that people love you, man. They love you. But just think what would happen if you went to City College. But here we were. And in my quest for more of this place, in walked a man by the name of Paul Robeson, who came to see what these young artists were doing in the basement of this library. We were doing a play called Juno and the Peacock, written by a great Irish playwright named Sean O'Casey. It was about the Irish rebellion against the British, and the contents of that play whetted our appetite. We loved it. It was filled with passion. And Robeson came to see us, this all-black cast, do this Irish play, because he was very close to Sean O'Casey, and he wanted to be able to go back and tell Sean O'Casey, the Irish are doing well in Harlem. Because we were doing that play. But when Robeson saw the play and talked to us, he gave us some instructions. He said, it's a wonderful thing that you have chosen the world of theater and the arts to be your goal. He said, artists are truly blessed. Artists and art, we are the gatekeepers of truth. And that idea that we were the gatekeepers of truth took this whole thing to another place. Gatekeepers of truth. What did that mean? And in our hunt for greater clarity on that prophetic remark, then led me in a quest for further study, further engagement, and I began to see art as a great social tool, as a great weapon. It was fraught with radical existence. And I went to the New School of Social Research with no credentials, because I had not been a high school graduate, and I was told you couldn't get in. But then I applied myself in my first great acting role. I threw myself on the mercy of all these white instructors about the need in our community for the development of black artists. And I wiggled into the system through their guilt. And how wonderful that my days in that classroom, my classmates were Marlon Brando and Walter Matthau and Rod Steiger and B. Arthur and Tony Curtis, on and on, all young people caught up in this place at the New School of Social Research, this place of study of the arts, who really understood the art as a social force. The man who headed it, his name was Erwin Piscotta. He came from Germany. He had fled the Nazis. But he was part of the great renaissance in German theater, the Max Reinhardt Theater. Part of the company was a great writer by the name of Bertolt Brecht. And he brought all of that to the place of study. And we saw art as a tool for not only personal growth and delight as an artist to be engaged in, but we saw its social purpose. And that was the only thing that drove most of us from that era. A lot of that has since been diminished. It is no longer central to many of the places of study that have institutions teaching about art. Nobody talks about the fact that we are the gatekeepers of truth, that we have social purpose. All you need is but take a look at what happens to American culture. I was struck the other night when I was watching CNN, trying to glean some information about this new virus that was plaguing us. And I never saw so many commercials as I saw in that space. And I realize that we are now overrun by Wall Street, that they have taken over all communication, that everything is in the service of power, in the service of profit, and anything that turns away from that can be crushed by a system that does not see art to be the gatekeepers of truth and does not want us to apply that to the systems of social change. Do not disrupt. And so, coming here is for me an opportunity to be a part of a system that's already obviously engaged in change. When I listened to the friends at dinner, I heard a lot of radical thought around the table. It made me feel for the first time on this tour that we're doing across America that I'd come to a place that was qualitatively different than what I was experiencing with other institutions of higher learning. And I've been to quite a few. And all of them were very generous and very warm, and some very responsive. But none of them kind of, in the very first moment, stimulated my sense of questioning, what is this strange place I'm in? Where is it headed? Why do these people talk this way? Why are they engaged as they are? What makes them so special? That question still stands, because I haven't been here long enough to find out. But if you see a bald-headed, aging guy walking around your turf, it's me hunting for answers that I might find here. America needs what this environment suggests it's about. I have to accept what I see. I also deal with what I feel instinctually. People here seem to have a greater sense of purpose. It is not just to perfect the craft and to make as much money as can be made. It's also somewhat preoccupied with what is the information you're sending forth. What are you saying? What will the students here leave feeling? What will be their desire? I have come to a place where I'm not too sure that I will be speaking publicly very much in the future. It's about time, and it's about what must be done. I spend most of my time greatly engaged in the prison system, the gathering for justice. I saw on television a 5-year-old girl, Aisha, from St. Petersburg, Florida. And on television, there was this picture of this 5-year-old child in her classroom being thrown across the desk, 3 white police officers having her little arms thrust up behind her back, handcuffing her. And she was on her way to be put on the prison blotter. She has now had her case beginning on this new Jim Crow. I called a friend of mine, as a matter of fact, two, both women. One was a young woman by the name of Constance Rice, who was an attorney with a group called How interesting that that name should skip away just at this moment. The Advancement Project, that's what it is. 7 women who came together as lawyers graduating from the Ivy League system and decided to go into poverty law. And boy, have they turned it over. They come out of California and Washington, D.C. So I called Connie. And she said, let's talk to Marion Wright Edelman. And Marion Wright Edelman said, the experience that you're looking at and what you're having is not unique. There are hundreds of cases around the country where children 10 years old and younger are being taken into the prison system. And what is the charge? The charge for this little girl was that she was being unruly in the classroom. It doesn't make sense, I thought. How can you take a 5-year-old child and handcuff her because she was unruly in the classroom? What happened to the system? What has happened to moral insight? What has happened to sense of social mission and purpose that we can let our children be incarcerated by a lot of police officers who are instructed to do what they do? Not necessarily because they want to, because certainly many of them have children of their own. They must see this indiscretion as something that they should be caught up with. And what did we do? And what do we do? The last view that I have before going into Q&A is this. We have watched a lot of people killed by the gun, and we watched this furious debate going on in America about the Second Amendment law and the right to bear weapons. And I suggest to you, although that is a worthwhile discussion to have, it skirts the issue. It skirts the greater truth. Why should 300 million Americans have 300 million guns? This is more than some just to protect oneself against the tyranny of the state. If and when that law was written, it was about the citizenry protecting itself against the state, and therefore muskets could be distributed among to ensure that the state did not overrun the population. That kind of makes sense. You could see that perhaps that process could work. But now the state possesses 30,000 nuclear warheads. The state possesses thousands and tens of thousands of sophisticated aircraft and tanks and mobility and guns and gas. No citizen will ever be able to arm themselves fully to stop the state if it is about tyranny. The only weapon that we have is justice and the law, and for us to engage in that way nonviolently. And nonviolence is the great radical thought of the day. And for those who would dismiss that, then I say to you, take a look at Tunisia. Take a look at Egypt. Take a look at Syria. Take a look at Occupy Wall Street. Take a look at some of the things going on in Chicago. Take a look at this ebb and tide among young people who are challenging the system, who are probing the system. That's what we did in our day. People thought of us as malcontents, as drifters, as people who sought to overthrow the government and to bleed the nation of its joy. Dr. King was called, and so was Nelson Mandela. They were called communists, and they were resisted by many systems in the state, including the New York Times, which denounced Dr. King vigorously for his position on the war in Vietnam and for other social declarations. Nelson Mandela was called a communist until only a few short years ago, 3 years, as a matter of fact. He was still on the State Department list as a terrorist. All these things are at play with this new moment in this opportunity for the application of radical thought. And nothing is more radical for the system that's coming at us and it's got us by the throat than the use of nonviolence and to impede those who profit from this misery and to stop the machine from being able to further motivate and justify that indifference that people who are possessed of money and opportunity who have turned their backs on the plight of those in our globe who are in need. It was nonviolence that ended the communist system in Russia, in the Soviet Union. If anybody had ever told you that not a shot would be fired and that this system would implode, one would have thought it was somehow a ridiculous thought, not based in any real understanding. But the truth is that it did implode. And that system, which in its earliest concept was meant to enhance socialist thought, turned out to be an instrument of tyranny. And then there's, of course, to take a look at South Africa. If anybody had told you that when black Africans became independent, the sense of revenge would be so intense that bloods of white people would be all over the continent. But that's not what happened. They went into a place of nonviolence. The transition took place, and now this democracy is working at trying to keep the citizens in a place of harmony as they sort out how to change the paradigm. There's a lot to work with, but it can only be achieved through the willingness to have radical thought. Theodore Roosevelt once said, and I'm paraphrasing here, he said, when the state reaches a place of tyranny, when the laws and those who make the laws begin to turn itself into tyranny, when it begins to shake the foundations of our Constitution and the things that our democracy is about, citizens not only have the right, but they have the responsibility to speak up and to speak out against such events. And if they don't, they should be charged with patriotic treason. And I often thought, what a wonderful way of saying those who have turned their back on the embracing of justice, of caring for those who are to be cared for, should really be charged with patriotic treason if they continue to go in the direction we're going and not try to change. So I thank you for giving me this platform. I thank you for giving me this opportunity to air these thoughts. So intimidating was the dinner tonight that I find myself, through the course of this delivery, looking to go to places where I might bring something that's more enlightening. But you stopped me at the gate, because I think you need to hear things that require greater thought and require more indulgence. I think you have something here that's very precious, and you should guard it, and guard it tenaciously. America needs to become radicalized. We need to be able to think outside the box. We need to be willing to go to places which is also endowed with a great sense of sacrifice. People say to me, what can I do to fix so and so and so? And I say to them, what are you prepared to sacrifice to see it done? Tell me of the generosity of your spirit and of your soul, and I can tell you how far I think we can go. Dr. King was possessed of that, the generosity of spirit, the willingness to give of himself. When I hosted the Tonight Show for a week, he was one of the guests during a remarkable week of high-profile citizens, not only great artists, but politicians. Bobby Kennedy was in that week. It was in February of 1968, and Dr. King was late getting to the show. And as a matter of fact, when we went on air, he had not yet arrived. And I was doing my opening song, getting ready to move on with the guest list, when I looked off and saw him in the wings, and he was nodding his head. And when I got him to the table, I said to him, thanks for coming, Martin. He said, Harry, let me just tell you that I'm really sorry that I was late. He said, but I got caught down in Atlanta. We had meetings. The plane was late. And I landed here in LaGuardia. And he said, I got into a cab, and I knew that the clock was against me. And I told this cab driver who recognized me, he said, what are you doing here in town, Dr. King? And he said, I told him that I was on my way to the Tonight Show. I was late, and that I had to be on the air. And he said, and that young man, rising to the occasion, took me on a ride that absolutely defied my sense of endurance. And when he stopped for a light, I tapped him on the shoulder quickly and said, young man, do me a favor. Could you just not take it easy, please? He said, I tell you, I am late, but I'd like to get there. I'd rather be known as Dr. King late than be known as the late Dr. King. I asked him at that moment, what about death, Martin? What do you think when you go off into battle about death? And he said, I've made my peace with it. He said, I no longer, and you saw part of that being revealed in the last speech down in Memphis, when he said, I've been to the mountaintop. I mean, I'd get there with you, but we're going to make it. He said, and I've made my peace with that. He said, it's not about how long you live. It's about what you do with the time you've got. What is the quality of your life and how you give it? What have you done to make the place, the world, a better place than the way in which you found it? And I hope that those who hear me and those who have access to so much truth and to so much radical thinking that's at your disposal, not only through the internet, but through institutions of learning and your libraries and everything, Frederick Douglass and John Brown and Fannie Lou Hamer and Ella Baker and Sojourner Truth, just filled with people who are radicals who left us a lot to work with. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much. We're going to move to a question and answer period, but before we do that, I'd like to present RISD students Alexander Dale and Yuki Kawai.
Okay. Mr. Belafonte, we are standing here tonight as representatives of our student community. I'm completely thrilled to be here. You have given us hope and energy to keep going and to have sense of purpose, like you say. We are a student community that represents 55 countries, a host of artistic traditions, and outstanding number of cultural backgrounds. We are honored that you have joined us as we remember the life, legacy, and charge of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. At this moment, we would like to present you with this RISD citation as a token of appreciation for your immeasurable commitment to the art and justice.
Thank you.
The Student Alliance of the Rhode Island School of Design honors Harry Belafonte for a distinguished legacy of artistic achievement, the strategic use of the arts in promoting social change, and his passionate pursuit of civil rights for all people. Thank you very much.
You're going to sit? All right. It is time for the question and answer session. I'm going to try to moderate this the best I can. We have a couple of people out in the audience with mics. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and someone will come to you. And then if you could please wait until obviously you're acknowledged to ask your question, that would make things run smoothly. We bring the house lights up just slightly, just a little bit more. That's better. Thank you. Great. So if you have a question, raise your hand. All right. Let's start on the right side here.
Well,
yes.
To answer your question.
Okay.
Hello?
Ashton, is that you? Yes,
yeah,
go ahead.
That's me. Hi, Daniel. How are you? Hi, Harry. My name's Ashton. I'm from Harlem, New York, the son of an immigrant family from West Africa, Benin. And my question was kind of addressing what you thought about maybe addressing radical change in today's generation of youth in Harlem, New York. And my question stems from, you want me to stand up? Can you see me? I'll stand up. My question stems from, growing up in a household where my dad used to watch a lot of abolitionist movements, you know, young or African-American abolitionist movements, and a lot of, like, radical speakers on television, and it kind of got me frustrated just because I didn't really feel a sense of individualism in all of that. You know, being forced down in the living room to watch a lot of what my dad was watching on CNN or C-SPAN, and then having to be born and raised in the hood where just there's a lot of, like, conforming to society. There's a lot of hip-hop being played around, and everybody around me was just trying to pretty much do what they saw on television or in the media. And I didn't really feel like as if I was I didn't feel as if becoming a part of that would make me live my life in the quality that I wanted it to. And so I kind of like kept in my bubble. And I feel like I separated myself a lot from people around me until the point where I became an artist or got introduced to the arts. And I was kind of geared towards taking in what I saw around me and translating it in whatever visual language that I saw fit to my artistic interest. And upon doing that, it was just for me. You know, it was something I did for myself to release myself artistically and cater to myself in a way that I didn't think my dad or the community around me was doing appropriately for me. And after doing so, like, I started realizing that the people who I thought weren't there to support me growing up were there to support me now when they saw me, you know, putting out this quality of work that they've never experienced before or that they've never seen coming out of their own community. And so this summer, I went back home and I felt this stronger sense of connection because I got that support that I never thought that I would ever receive from the community that I never thought that I was ever too close to. So I started thinking about a project that could maybe, magnify a lot of the artistic skills that I've accomplished over the years amongst the community, and then distribute that amongst the community, back to the community, to the youth in particular. So myself and some friends organized a bunch of papers and, you know, talked to a lot of people. And we tried to start a program called the Neo Harlem Renaissance, which would it would get a lot of the artists in the community, not just Harlem, but a lot of you know, hoods all around New York to convene and make a lot of artworks in different fields and then promote them in galleries and whatnot, and get an opportunity to show our works without, you know, the limitations of the media and what people naturally think about youth coming up in hoods. And a surprising obstacle that I've experienced along the way was actually the community of black leaders in Harlem. When we went to speak to them about the idea, I sat there and gave my little spiel after they finished talking about a lot of like small stuff that was going on in the community. And after my, I think, 2-minute spiel, there were about 5 or 10 leaders in the room that couldn't ask any other question but like, oh, where did you go to school? Like, why do you talk so well? Blah, blah, blah. And it was just like, I thought that there was not enough support to project this idea that we, the youth, had in the community to becoming a reality from the elders of our community. And a struggle that I find now is finding a way to merge the plight of the elders with the youth. And I was wondering if you had any insight on how to come up with a radical idea that can do such a thing, you know? Like, how do you talk to old people, quote, quote, you know?
Yes? Yes.
What did he say?
The question is,
good.
How do young people work with previous generations to create social change? All right.
Give that a shot.
Was that your question? You'll have to forgive me. I was not able to hear everything that you said and tried to glean what the question may be. I think every generation needs to be responsible for itself, and it needs to find its way to solution, not just being inspired by those who came before you and who used certain techniques and methodology, but to be inspired by what you know about the circumstances in which you are caught and what are the best tools for fixing. Certainly when we came out of the Second World War, when we were looking at America, when the war machine was being turned into instruments for peace, when young servicemen were coming back with great expectations, the harshness that we found in the environment defied solution. Because when you finish a big war and you say that all the things you fought for were embodied in what that war is about, only to come home and find that that was not the case, you have to reinvent a whole process and how to fix what's wrong. I look at the young people today, and my children and my grandchildren are part of that population, and I say, what a terrible time they are inheriting. For us, there were signs that said, no niggers allowed, no this, no that. There were signs that said, back of the bus. There were things that were in your face. You could not vote. That was a matter of law. And you looked at all of these things, and sometimes the path the solution was very clear. Not that it wasn't complicated, but clarity was there. What has happened is that we have changed the visual dynamic. We have no longer see signs that say that. But the spirit of that oppression still abounds. It's still in the American heart. It's still in the American soul. Not all citizens, but enough citizens to make it a serious problem. I cannot look at the Tea Party. I cannot look at what has happened in the past years with the right wing that has risen up so aggressively and tenaciously to crush the better part of what America is, and not find servicing the needs of young people to work their way out of that abyss, not abundantly evident. I think the tide is somewhat turned. Institutions that have joined us in our great quest for change were made up of workers, were made up of people in unions. I think in those days, 40% or 47% of all the American workforce belonged to organized labor. Today, it's around 6%. That's how severely the labor force has been diminished. Certainly, the church, which in many ways was at the forefront of that change, has long since capitulated its responsibilities and its focus on what Dr. King wrote about so eloquently in letters from a Birmingham jail when he spoke to the ecumenical community and said, "Where is your service for the poor?" I think that if you go to the internet and you look up at the prophetic teachings of Frederick Douglass, of the founding fathers of this country, despite the fact that some of them were slaveholders, they had other visions of a democratic mission that were to be of benefit to us. Certainly, the great civil war in this country, which was stimulated by slave rebellion, was also constitutionally framed, even adding youth articles to the Constitution, like the 13th Amendment, which didn't exist in the beginning. But there is this need, I think, for those who are genuinely in the quest of change to study the masters, to study what was said before your time by those who faced the same challenges that you faced in your time. And you'll find that there is abundant information, abundant stimulus. As much as I lived in the period of the civil rights movement, I still carry in my computer and little passages on my iPhone, although I could carry most of it. I carry Dr. King's voice. I carry his speeches. And I sometimes, when I have a moment of stress and query as to what to do with a problem that's emerging, how do you treat the fact that there are so many inequities, yet you have a black president? What does your blackness do with that information if you need to challenge the fact that there is still more to be done? What do you do with your blackness if you find that there are those who have become parts of the instruments of governance who are willing to lie and to betray the trust and lead us into war? What do you do with the Condoleezza Rices? And what do you do with the Colin Powells? And if you dare to speak up about the fact that they have betrayed the process, there's a price to be paid. And I think that when you ask the question, what do we do, where do we go, You have to first ask yourself that question that I said at the end of the speech. What are you prepared to give up for it? What are you prepared to sacrifice? Certainly, many of us who did what we did understood with great clarity that a bullet could snuff us out at any moment. That still is a fact of today, especially with so many guns around and so much insanity. What price are you willing to pay for change? And if you can say that I'm willing to give my life for it, then I think you'll find abundant ways in which to make a difference. If, however, you are caught in the divide and you somehow want to have it all, then I say that's not possible. Something has to give. And the question is, what are you willing to give for change? If you are willing to give enough, then I think there are many ways in which to get in touch with me, get in touch with the institutions I belong to, get in touch on an international basis. I didn't know any of those kids in Tunisia when the rebellion started. I didn't know any of them in Libya. But I found out who they were, and I got in touch, not only through staff and people that created a dialogue and an exchange, but I also tapped into the people that I knew here, and the Bloods and the Crips and in the prison system and all the places where I reside daily. And I said, let's have a dialogue with those folks. Right now we're making a picture called, it's a documentary actually, called Another Night in the Free World. And it's taking a look at rebellion in the international community by those who are leading a charge against indifference and against the oppression of those who have power and those who refuse to yield to the needs of so many people who are suffering. I think we have a unity and a place with all those people. What do you know about them? What do you know about them really? Not just what you see on CNN, but what attempts have you made to, hey, let's hook it up, let's talk, come to America, let's use the Skype. Let's talk face to face. We have a dialogue going on that will astound you. And don't expect to see that dialogue on the Tonight Show. Don't expect to see that dialogue being revealed in CNN breaking news. It is to the oppressive institution's interest to keep that off the record. You have to hunt for it. But the minute you find the vein of that artery or the blood in that artery, you will be led to a place where the information will be a flood of choices that you can make. You have to talk to people who are coming from a place other than where you reside. I hope that what you were saying and the way in which what you said was interpreted, I have answered with some clarity. If not, then I would tell you that you can come backstage or meet me with the reception afterwards, and I'll give you a number you can call so we can get it on one-on-one. Because I don't want you to leave dissatisfied.
Thank you. Next question on the left side over here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Belafonte. And mine is more of just a thank you, not a question. My name is Simone Spruce-Torres, and I am a painter and illustrator, and I have been an activist artist since age 6. So I just wanted to thank you for paving the way for activist artists and, you know, showing us the type of leadership that we needed and the resources that we know how we needed to use to make. And I also wanted to say that your movie showed the great sacrifices that you have to make when you're on the front lines of activism. So just thank you.
Thank you.
Another question right up here.
Should I stand up? Hi. I've been thinking about this question for like 2 weeks, so I hope I express myself eloquently. But I understand that you follow the politics of Fidel Castro. And my family immigrated from Cuba in 1960, not only because they disagreed with his politics, but also because he basically stole everything from that they worked for. And so I was brought up to think that Fidel was, you know, corrupt, a murderer, like basically just like an evil person. So I was just like, and I don't mean to disrespect you in any way, but you've done like so much good for the world that I just want to know, what is it that allows you to follow his politics? That, because I've always believed him, to be pretty bad.
No, I must tell you that acoustically, we're not receiving up on stage. There's no monitors and whatnot. And
it's hard to see too. Yeah. Okay, so the question is, she is from a family that fled Castro's Cuba, and she was brought up to understand Fidel Castro as essentially a bad person. Therefore, she wanted to get your understanding of Castro. Does that make sense? Am I doing okay? I'm trying here. Okay, so.
Is that about it? Good. In my earliest years as a musician, looking at jazz as the place in which I wanted to plant myself and harvest the best in my art, I met a lot of musicians who were Cubans. This was back in the 40s. And I went to Cuba with some regularity, especially when I became quite accepted. It was just a few minutes from Miami, and I could drop down at any time into Havana and watch the mafia rape the Cuban people of their resources, watched all of the world flood to participate in the joys of the prostitutes which roamed the streets. I saw children who were beggars, and I also saw people who were filled with a dignity and a history that was really quite astounding. And in the midst of this rather conflicted place, I got to know some students who came to Columbia University in New York, and we began to have an exchange. And they told me about their hopes for Cuba's future. And they told me about their experiences under Batista, who was the dictator. And when the forces of rebellion and revolution emerged with Fidel Castro and those who overthrew Batista, I was part of a throng of overjoyed citizens globally that saw great hope in what was being achieved by that revolution. I subsequently met Castro, first when he came to New York. He resided in Harlem at the Teresa Hotel. He moved among black people as a matter of social choice. And then he spoke before the United Nations. I was invited to come to Cuba for the film festival. And I went to Cuba and I met some of the most astounding citizens I ever met in the world. It was there that I met Gabriel Garcia Marquez from Colombia, living in Mexico, one of the great literary minds of that century and today even. I met Jorge Amado, who came from Brazil, one of the great writers of that culture. I could meet these men only in Cuba, because America had shut its doors to these citizens because they were considered dangerous to the state, to the American people. Marquez used to say, with some fascination that he didn't quite understand our system in barring him from coming. Because he came, and under the law and the rules, he could only move within a very small parameter. Around 50 miles, I think, was the law of how far these undesirables could move if they came to visit in America. And he says, and he came here because he had cancer and needed to have it treated. And the best and most advanced treatment was in America, but we made it very difficult for him. And he said, you know, I'm fascinated that they keep me away physically from coming to America because they think of my social and political thoughts and philosophy. When what in fact they should be banning is the thing that most penetrates the American society, and that is my books. You can buy them by the tens of thousands and read anything, but you can't speak to me. Now, I make that picture because here is the following. I needed to know what was going on with the socialist experiment. I needed to know what this was as just another place that erupted from dozens of places around the globe that was turning its back on the things that America offered because they found those things invalid to the kinds of societies they wanted. I don't think most of these people that went into communist states and went into socialist states were seeking to have tyranny. Power corrupts. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. And one of the things that I learned from Dr. King, if you don't speak to those with whom you have differences, then all you're doing is speaking to those who share your thoughts and therefore mutes your advancement to grow and to learn and to know. I found it extremely important that I not only speak to many artists and people that made up the Castro regime, but to speak to Castro himself, to see where could we find common ground, where could we talk about things, especially with artists who had the greatest access of any group culturally. We could speak to one another, we could write to one another, we could sing to one another, we could paint about each other. How do you access that? And you access it by going and talking and meeting. Why did our system shut the door on that possibility in the name of what? Not permitting Cuba to undermine our society and overtake our country? Isn't that a little silly? Does that thought make sense? And if you find them, so why can't you sit and talk and have exchange, whether it's in the United Nations or with each other? Certainly when I was with Dr. King, where I learned this, was that if I was not talking to the hardcore right-wing white adversaries in the South who created the laws of oppression, if you didn't change them and change their thinking, then who else was there to talk to? You talk to your adversaries. And I found that in my conversations and exchanges with Fidel Castro, often things were advanced in a way that I thought offered great hope. There are things about the communist dogma and about the way in which the society is governed that I found unacceptable. But shutting the door to no dialogue was equally as abhorrent, if not even more so. When I went to Cuba on a trip not too long ago, during the festival, I was talking to some musicians in the National Hotel during lunch break, and I saw a couple of young black Cubans chatting over in the corner, and their eyes caught each other, and I went over to their table, and they spoke enough English for us to have an exchange. And I asked them, what did they do? And they said they were artists. And I asked them, what is your art form? And they said, we're musicians. And I said, what kind of music do you play? And they said, we're rap artists. I said, you're rappers? I said, yes. And I said, well, I don't hear much about you here in Cuba. And they said, well, that's because the doors of opportunity are closed to us. First of all, we're black, and we live in old Havana, and race prejudice still abounds, although our constitution and laws would profess otherwise. That afternoon, I was having lunch with Fidel Castro and some of the members from the cultural ministry, and he said, how do you find Cuba? And I told him what I thought about the exchanges we were having during the festival. And then I got on to this thing about the Cuban rappers. And I said, you said that you have a non-racial society, and you talk about the openness of the society, yet I just met two young black Cubans from old Havana that said that that is not the case. They have no access. And you're shutting off one of the most interesting dynamics in world culture, which is, where does rap go? What does it become? It's capturing the voice and the tongue of so many. And Fidel Castro, at that moment, said, what are you saying? And he said, I need to hear more. So our lunch, which was just for an hour, which is the time allotted, turned into be the rest of the day, because he was curious about this thing that I had seen in his Cuba, in his Havana. Cut a long story short, the following year when I went back to the festival, I was greeted by a group of young people in the hotel, and one young lady carried some flowers. And I said, well, thank you, and what is this for? She said, it's from us to thank you for what it is that you said to Fidel Castro, because now all the rappers in Cuba have a far more open place in which to express ourselves. We are now have our own recording center, and we're now a part of the official recognition by the cultural ministry. We also travel to many places in Latin America we didn't go before, and we're now experiencing that in Latin America, we're the number one record from the rap culture, and we are Cubans. To me, whatever is being said in the halls of power and what is being exchanged in these negotiations has missed what we artists are able to find with one another and to say. When artists from Cuba see what I do and the way many of us do it, and when Wynton Marsalis and jazz and all of the things we sent to Cuba, we have an open door. We have a way of integrating our thoughts and our feelings, criticizing the system there and criticizing the system here. And in this exchange, we find a greater humanity and a more reasonable way in which to make differences less confrontational. That's the best way I can describe it. Those of us who are my detractors will tell you that I'm a communist sellout, that I'm somehow wishing for the demise of my country and all the rest of it. Why they are so afraid that if we speak to the enemy, we may say something that is contrary to policy is a very important question for Americans to ask themselves. This blockade against Cuba has gone on for 50 years. The only people who have suffered from that, besides the Cubans economically, are Americans who never had a chance to delight themselves in Cuba, Cuban music, Cuban art, the Cuban people, who I think are bound with great promise. And I'm glad that those of us who could keep those doors of communication open did what we did. And I think you'll find now in Cuba the greatest advocate, with the acceptance of the state, on gay rights and the gay movement in Cuba is Raul Castro's daughter, who not only speaks fluent English, who's educated, has come to America, and now you have in Cuba, which was before a state hostile to a sexual difference, and sexual choice, now most embracing of it. We've opened that up. The blockade didn't do that. Communication between citizens and artists helped move the boundaries. That is why I go to Cuba. That's what I delight in. And I learned a lot from the Cuban people, and I'm inspired by the kind of work that Cuban musicians do. And I wish that America could open itself up to some of these possibilities. If my answer is not satisfactory and you'd like to continue the dialogue, I'll give you the same number I'm going to give to him. We can keep this up.
I was going to say that we are out of time, so I want to thank everyone for their thoughtful questions, and thank you for coming to Rhode Island School of Design. We are going to have a short 10-minute break, and then at 9:30, Mr. Belafonte will be available here up on stage to sign copies of his autobiography, My Song. If you don't already own a copy, you may purchase the book in the lobby. The line for signatures, I think, is going to begin on this side of the stage. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a good night.
Absolutely inspirational.
Thank you.
I wish there was like a bigger word that was about this big. When I collect my